Okay, so I will create a new group so we can work on it from the Google Groups for Business. And I will name this group HR. I will keep the access level as it is now because I will change it from the Groups for Business page. And I will click Create. So I will go directly to the Groups for Business so we can work with this group from there. Okay, here is the Groups for Business interface. First of all, we'll have to add members. So I will go to members. And we have multiple ways to add members here. We can send invitations or we can directly add them to this group. So I'll go to direct add members and let's enter the email addresses here. Also, we will get autocomplete. If you want to give them a welcome message, we can type it directly here. If you don't want and we want to keep it to the default, I'll just click add. And that's it. We go to all members and we can see that we have two members. Basically, both of these two guys are on the member role. So we have the option to promote one of them to be a manager or owner. It's worth to mention that the Groups for Business have one additional role, which is manager. As you noticed in the Google Admin Console groups, we have only two roles. We have member or owner. In here, we have three roles. So let's make Sarah Smith the owner for this group. So we select the user account and then we go to actions and then we go to add to role. As you can see, we have owner and manager. I'll make her the owner here. And as you can see, now we have Sarah Smith as the owner. Same thing goes if you want to make test user 08 as a manager. All you have to do is select the user, go add to role, and then we select the role that we want. If you want to demote Sarah Smith, then we'll select her account again and we go to add to role. Then you can see the option called remove from role and you can select owner. She will go back to the member role. We can also ban the user account. We can change the delivery settings for her. So this means the notification settings. And we can also set specific posting permissions for this user account. For example, if you have a group that we do not want anyone to send emails to this group, even the owner or the manager, but only one specific user should be sending emails to this group, we can override the default sending permissions for this group on that specific user account. Right now we are seeing the active members of this group, but we have the option also to see the banned members, and we have also the option to export the members to a CSV file or a text file as well. And we also have the option to search for members inside this group if it has a very large number of users. Before we move away from the members, as you can see also we have an option called join requests. So we can have the option that users request to join to the group and then one admin or one manager or owner of this group can see these requests. So either approve or deny these requests. Right now of course we do not have any pending requests. Moving next to the messages. This view gives us the option to see any pending message that we have in the group. When we activate the message moderation, nobody will be able to post any message or send an email to this group without being approved by an owner or a manager or somebody who has the role for that. So all the pending messages will be shown in here. So we have some options here on the top in this view. The first one is the approval button. So basically you will select the pending message or post and you click this button. So the post or message will be approved and sent to the group. The next option here is trusting the author or the sender of that post or message. So any post or message that is sent by this specific author that you are selecting from here will be automatically approved and sent to the whole group. The third option, it's to ban the author or the sender of this message. So in case somebody sends something inappropriate or sends somebody not related to the subject of the group, you can just select the message that is related to him and then you can ban the author completely. The final option is to delete the pending message or to reject it. So in case if you do not want to block the sender or the author, you can just delete his message and have it rejected. Moving to the settings section, we have first the email options. It basically allows you to change the various settings that are related to how emails are sent from this group. You can add footers, you can add subject prefix to this group, and you can also change the maximum message size for this group. Right now it's using the default, but you can have one of these options as the maximum message size. Moving to the identity. Here it allows you to change how the usernames or the user identities appear inside the group. So basically by default it's shown to either the display name or the Google profile. So the username will be either his Google profile name or the display name of the account. You can actually change it from here. The default is good actually, so it doesn't matter really, unless you need some specific way of displaying the user's identity. Moving next to the moderation, it's here where you enable the message moderation, so nothing will be posted to this group without an admin or an authorized person approve this message. You can set up a custom notification to notify the owner of this message when the moderator has rejected his message as well. And you can specify how to treat the spam messages. By default, they will be sent to the moderation queue and a notification will be sent to the moderators. Then finally, you have the option to enable tags and categories here. Basically, these are good way to categorize and make the content of this group search friendly really. Topics and discussions will be sorted based on tags and categories that are either typed by the user or the poster of this message. So it's really a good idea to enable those if you are expecting a lot of content and a lot of interaction with this group later on. Moving next to the permissions group, we have the basic permissions here, and basically these are just the important permissions about the group. So we have view topics permission, who is allowed to view the topics of this group. Basically it's set to all members of this group and all organization members. It means everyone inside the domain. You can change this to however it suits you or suits the need of this group. And then also we have the post option. It means who can post or send messages to this group. Also, it has been set to everyone inside this domain, so you can change it as well based on the need of this group. Note that you have an option called public. This was not available in the admin console groups. This option basically opens the group to the whole internet. If you select this one, everybody from the internet will be able to send to this email address of this group. You might need this if you have a collaborative mailbox group acting as a support account, so we'll have to turn this on to allow the support agents to receive emails on that group. Then we have the option to join the group, and also it is set to anyone in the organization, but you can change it to only invited members or anyone in the organization can ask, so their join request will be moved to the join requests here and an admin can approve or deny their request. Moving down to the posting permissions, basically, these settings are related to how users can post messages or topics to this group. There are really a lot of permissions here. However, I will highlight some important permissions of these. One of them is assign topic. This option actually is useful when you are using a collaborative mailbox. So one user or one agent can take or assign this message or post to himself or another person so he can work on that ticket or case. We also have the option called Me Too, or the permission called Me Too. And basically, if you also have a support forum and somebody posts a message about a problem that he's having, instead of a user typing that I have this problem too or Me Too, there is a button actually. He will just click it and people will know that he also has this problem. Also, we have the post permission here, which is also a duplicate from the one found in the basic permissions. We have also post announcements, and by default is not selected. So you can select actually who can post announcements to this group. You would have to make it the owner of this group, or you need to create a specific role for this announcement. I will show you the roles later on. The other important permission is the post as the group permission. And basically, instead of somebody who wants to send an email through this group, instead of showing his own email address, the email address of this group will be shown in the from sender. This is good if you have a support group or if you have a careers group, for example, or whatever need that you don't want the recipient to know who is sending these emails. They will only see, for example, HR or projects, for example. So for the posting permissions, I believe these are the most important permissions that you will need and you will have to change often or mostly. Next is the moderation permissions. So basically these are permissions for users who can add members to the group or approve members or approve messages to this group, or even can ban users or delete posts that are posted by other members as well. You don't need to change these too often because based on the group type that you will choose, these will be predefined and pre-configured for you. However, it's good that you have a role, at least one role for messages and members approvals in case you are using moderation for members and emails and messages. The next option is the access permissions, and basically these permissions are how the group is being viewed or getting access from external or internal members. So you have options to allow the users to contact the owner of this group, or you have the option to allow the view of the members of this group, or the view of the email addresses, or even the view of the topics. So you can, for example, prevent anyone who is not member from this group from viewing the topics or viewing the member list. This might be useful if you have a projects group, or if you have a group that you do not want anyone to know who is member of. For example, the executives group or the finance group. Moving next to the roles page. It's basically where you can create your own custom roles. So if you want to create a role only to approve messages or to approve member requests, you can just do it from here. You'll create the role from here, and then you'll go to the permissions and give that role the permissions that you need. Next is the information group. And basically, these are the information about this group itself, the name of the group, the email address, and even the types of allowed topics in this group. Then you have the directory page where you can choose to list this group in the directory or not. This is also useful for groups that you don't want users to send emails too often, like the executives group, or if you have a specific group that is only for specific people. Then you have content control, where you can have the option to choose either to allow archiving or not archiving the group content. Then in the web view customization, you have the option actually to change two things in the web view of this group, which is this interface. First one, you can have the option to display the best answer above all other replies, so the good information can be found quickly. And you have also the option to enable or disable the conversation mode, which is actually similar to the one found in the Gmail. It will group messages or emails based on the subject. Then finally, here is the settings for the subject length, and it can be maximum of 250 characters. You can, however, reduce it to be minimum of 80, or be something between 80 and 250. Finally, the advanced page, where you actually can delete the group, or you can reset the group type. So this is really helpful and nice feature that will allow you to quickly reconfigure the group to be one of these four types, as I explained in the beginning. You can reconfigure the group to the default settings of an email list, or the default settings of a web forum, or at the default settings for a Q&A forum, or the collaborative inbox. So all you have to do is select the type that you want, click reset this group, and that's it. Or you can just click delete this group, and this group will be deleted. So we've talked about the types of the groups, and we saw that we have two main types of groups, and the groups for business has four subtypes. Each one of these has its own use case and use need. Then we saw how to create the groups, one of each type. After this, we went immediately to the settings and permissions of the Google Groups for Business. There is actually a lot to do in these groups, and there are a lot of permissions and settings in Google Groups for Business. They are really flexible and can be configured to match any use case or any need for us. The only problems really that I have came across through my work and through the projects that I have done are basically the administrators are not aware of the many permissions and the many settings they can do in Google Groups for Business. They get confused when they open the Groups for Business interface, and they get lost on how to add users and how to change the posting permissions and how to even override the default posting permissions for some specific users. So I'd really recommend that you try and create multiple groups, multiple testing groups if you want, just to get yourself familiar with these permissions and settings, and after that I believe everything should be easy and straightforward. Before we close this topic, I really wanted to share with you these three links. These will take you to the Google Help site, and these are really helpful and useful articles about Google Groups. So with this, we will move next to the organizational units management, and this should not be a very long topic really. We will first get to know what are OUs and what is the need for OUs, and after that we're going to see how we're going to manage users and services based on the OUs and the inheritance also of the OUs. So until then, I hope this was informative for you, and I'd like to thank you for viewing.